So let me talk to Mr. Mathur. Mr. Mathur, how is the competitive landscape, you know, for you as a domestic solar module manufacturer, solar cell and module manufacturer in the country? How do you see the competition from imports, and what are the constraints for an Indian player to scale up against the import competition? That's one. Number two, what kind of technology improvements that you are looking at to improvise on the solar module efficiency going forward? Okay, so maybe you can just share your perspective on these two.
Yeah, so we are a cell and module manufacturer both. So what we see in terms of domestic, currently in terms of cell manufacturing, we have about 3 plus gigawatt of cell capacity in India. I would say about 8 to 10 gigawatt of module capacity. India has primarily, we have never been able to develop the manufacturing culture in India. And I think Make in India is a great initiative by the government to change that. India has primarily been a service-based economy, and China has taken that leap. And so in solar industry, in 2009, 2010, Europe and Japan and US used to be the pioneers in solar, and suddenly China came in and, you know, megawatt became gigawatt and gigawatt became multi-gigawatts. So in India also, you know, last few years you have seen that cell manufacturing came, and then China just dominated the market, and a lot of these cell manufacturers have been sitting idle. So the initiative which the government has taken, what we see is that cell manufacturing, especially with the domestic content coming in, we see that this cell manufacturing can rapidly become 6 gigawatt, from 3 gigawatt to 6 gigawatt in less than maybe 18 to 24 months, which is a huge leap. And our statistics says that almost 80 to 90%, rather 80% imports is happening from China itself, and almost 10% is coming from countries other than China, Vietnam, Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia, those countries, Taiwan. And our local manufacturing has been struggling, even though safeguard duty came in, but since it was for a limited period of time, it did not bring in that impact. And so when we see that all these initiatives from the government is to bring jobs into India, and jobs will come if your EPC is doing well, the manufacturing is doing well, ancillaries are being developed. That's how jobs are created, and the money or the rupee remains in India rather than going into China. China, if you see, has rapidly grown their manufacturing, and there's a lot of dumping that happens from China. So they have been dominating the prices globally, so that has also happened in India. So we took the initiative of developing a solar technology park. So we are not only doing cell and module manufacturing, we are also doing EVA. We also have a back sheet which we have an ancillary which is doing that within the solar technology park. We are also adding frames, and frames is going to come very soon, and junction box is next in line. So we want to reduce the content that goes into the module also to, you know, Indian content mainly. And so that is how we are growing. I think other companies are also doing the same in India. So that's what their plan is. Once we have that kind of a stability in terms of demand from the market, I'm sure manufacturing can rapidly grow in India, like it has happened in other countries. So, you know, why would India be left behind?
Okay. Other question is, are you seeing a green shoots, or are you seeing some visibility in demand for domestic OEMs from Make in India initiative or a CPSU program. So what has been the progress so far, and what has been the benefit so far for domestic OEMs?
Domestic OEM would
solar be? OEMs under CPSU program under in terms of getting the orders.
Yes. So there was another question which you asked was about the efficiencies and the wattages. So in terms of modules, so earlier it used to be 156.25 and then it became 156.75 size of the cell or the wafer, which you can say. And so our efficiencies currently, our modules in multi are in the range of 340, 345 watt peak, which is higher or sometimes in compared to some Chinese companies, we are even better than the efficiencies which they are able to give. And globally, we are at par or better than other competitors. So our wafers now currently, you know, we are also growing the size. So it will be 166 in another few months, maybe in a year's time. So modules, efficiency and all, we are at par and sometimes even better than the best tier one Chinese manufacturers. When we talk about multi, mono has not been very, very prevalent in Indian conditions, but that is going to change and we are aware of that. And so that because of that, our new expansions, which we are going to do, will be on mono. And so you would see 400, 420 watt panels soon coming from Adani and from other module manufacturers as well. In terms of CPSU, which you are talking about, so we are very encouraged with that, though it's early days. And this is the first year where basically CPSU has started playing out. So NTPC has few biddings have happened, tranche one, tranche two. So that has happened. But that will all start happening. So there have been allocations to various EPC IPP companies who have bid for that. So that is going to happen. Probably in the next financial year, we should see some movement there.
Okay, great. Let me come to Mr. Sumit as an IPP player. The question is on the bid tariff viability for an IPP. You know, we have seen the competitively bid tariffs for the solar sector in last 2 years remaining below 3 rupees. Okay, touching all-time low at 243. But after that, we have started seeing an upward trend. How do you see that trend going forward, given the various challenges that we discussed just now, related to execution, related to the financing environment, and so on? Do you see this bid tariff expectation showing an upward trend in the near future, considering the execution challenges and also the price module price behavior in the international markets?
Actually, bid tariff is not only the EPC cost, only model cost. It comes together with all the parameters. So once any IPP runs a model, it's on the basis of financing cost, equity returns, expectations of the company, project execution expectation, then on that basis, project execution issues, or considering what all wrong might happen in the project. So there are multiple parameters on the basis of what it changes. Now, why the tariffs are going up? First reason is very much obvious, that model prices have gone up. If not model prices have gone up, safeguard duty has come up. Going down the line, customs duty is also expected, so that our Indian manufacturers come up and we are not dependent on China or any other country every time. This increases the model prices and this is reflected in the tariffs as of now. So I guess that will remain there. Another portion because of which tariff goes on increasing is the project cost increase at the particular locations. If we see Rajasthan and Gujarat are hubs, then comes Karnataka, especially for solar ISTS type of projects, basically interstate connected type of projects. Now, yesterday only Rajasthan has come up with the solar policy. that has a component which says of RREDF, basically Renewable Energy Development Fund. Earlier it was 1 lakh per megawatt. Post commissioning for 25 years, all the developers had to pay if they are selling the power out of Rajasthan. Now most of the projects which are coming up obviously are not going to sell in Rajasthan, it's going out. That was changed in draft policy to 5 lakh per megawatt. Now that is a big change. Now they have finally changed it to step-wise, year-wise, 2020, 21, 22, 24. So basically again that is an increasing trend, 1 lakh, 2 lakh, 3 lakh, 4 lakhs. So this is increasing the input cost for the project. So obviously because of that, as I earlier told, that we have to represent the same to the MNRE. They have understood, and the benchmark tariffs you might have already seen, 265, and recent now latest bids it is 278. Still the bids are not coming. Two reasons. One is AP fallout, and another reason is basically so that those projects have clarity, then people will start investing in new projects. And another portion is grid evacuation. Grid evacuation cost also goes on increasing because substation right now is at 10 kilometers. The land, once the projects are developed within those 10 kilometers, people will go out and will go up to the 20 kilometer, 30 kilometer, 40 kilometer. In wind, we have seen the cases wherein the projects are 70, 80 kilometers away. So 70, 80 kilometer transmission line, 220 kV or 400 kV is being built by IPP. Just because it doesn't want to be dependent on any government agency. But then this takes time. This is cost and also execution risk. So obviously, wind tariffs have already gone up to the level of 288 or might be expected up. Benchmark is now 283 as per recent bids. Solar has also gone up, and which might go up depending on how on the modules basic customs duty comes, or again safeguard duty comes, it will increase on that basis.
Yeah, certainly. So while these are the genuine factors which is leading to cost increase, as you rightly pointed out, but that's the one side. But if you look at the government side story, they're putting a cap in the bidding regime. So what is the industry view on that? And there is apparently an opposition against the cap. While the projects are being awarded through a bidding route, what's the necessity of certain cap?
See, the in bidding, the cap is given not because they wish to have that rate, but again, SECI, NTPC or whatever these big bids are coming up, they are not consuming the power. At the end of the day, the power is being sold to state DISCOMs. State DISCOMs might be UP, Bihar, especially those states which doesn't have good financial credibility, because people don't directly go to those states and sign the PPAs under their bidding route. So SECI comes up to resolve their issues. Now when SECI comes up, it is backed by central government guarantee or collateral or something. Everyone has in mind that central government will help the developers not to fall out. Now once this is there, SECI has to sell power. So bidding route is done, plus 7 paisa of the trading margin. So effectively the tariff at which DISCOM gets power is more. Already we know the condition of DISCOMs. They hardly want to procure power, or already some states are excess power, or they want the power which is at 244, which is the benchmark in the market that Rajasthan is getting it. So everyone should supply that power. So SECI or NTPC face that problem again, that it is sold to DISCOMs. That's why they come up with the price range wherein DISCOMs agree to sign the PSAs, back-to-back PSAs with them. And this is the reason why benchmark is there.
Yeah. So let me talk to Mr. Mathur. How do you see the module price outlook? I think that's a key variable for all of us to understand domestically, internationally. What's your observation and what's the outlook?
That's a $1 million question. $1 billion question. As I said earlier, we expect that the LCOE will go down. So overall cost of ownership will go down. Short term, long term, there are a lot of factors which comes in, like, you know, and because polysilicon prices are all controlled from China. So, we see that short term there might be some because Chinese New Year is coming. After that, China will declare their policies for the next year, and that becomes a big factor because China, if the policy is favorable, then they're busy in the market. If not, then this China-US trade war coming to an end, there might be some negotiations happening there. So China will have more access to US market, which was not earlier available. So we see that prices will not go up for sure, not for sure, but will remain in this level next year also. We don't see a major change in the prices because China will be busy in their market and also in other markets, which coincidentally, if you see globally now, it's a 120-130 gigawatt global market where China can sell. So prices will remain in the same zone next year is what we feel.
Other question is, all the module sourcing, I mean, these modules come with the warranty terms, right? And the warranty terms are pretty long tenure warranty terms. What's your observation on the honorability of these warranty contracts by the solar OEMs domestically and internationally?
So that's what we have been telling our customers all around, few years, that it's very important where you get the modules from. We have seen top Chinese companies failing year on year. So it's very important where you get those modules from. There are almost 150 module manufacturers in India currently. Could be more also, because there's one coming every day. But it's important who you source your modules from, because when price becomes the key, a lot of these people can cut corners if they are not busy. EVA has a shelf life. If it is not properly refrigerated or cold conditions, or the cross-linking happens, so EVA can, if expired EVA or not stored properly EVA is used, that can delaminate after a year. So modules, they all look same, and specifications also look the same. It's like you're buying a television, you have a Sony and you have a Samsung and you have a Micromax TV also, and specifications are all the same, sometimes even better. But you still buy a Sony or a Samsung because it's the specification, but also the reliability of the product. You have to see that, you assume that television has to last for 5 years. You have to see that every day. Imagine you are buying a panel at a 1 rupee cheaper price, which has to last for 25 years on the roof. What kind of risk you're getting into buying from a cheap module manufacturer who will not be able to stand with the guarantee because he has just invested in a second-hand laminator in some shed and maybe like a 50 lakh investment. Tomorrow his business fails, he closes the shop and he runs away, and your warranty is just a piece of paper you're carrying along. And we have seen this year on year, a lot of companies have failed. And that's what I'm talking about, the small manufacturers you can buy from India. Then there are other manufacturers from China, these tier one manufacturers. Firstly, China does not honor any contracts because, and you have heard the story globally that if any contracts, especially if you're less than 100 megawatt kind of a customer, if something goes, or maybe even a 5-10 megawatt customer, if something goes bad in your panels, for them who are doing a 10 gigawatt kind of manufacturing, for them a 5 megawatt project customer has no voice and cannot have a legal, because the contracts are all written from China perspective. They don't honor the laws of India. In the future, we have seen companies like LDK used to be the largest manufacturer at one time, failed. Yingli used to be their largest. They also sponsored the World Soccer tournament in South Africa, if I'm not wrong. They are nowhere now. Suntech used to be there. And these are all number one at one time globally. And there are others as well. Renezola went and gone, came back. So, and could be 5-10 different more. These are all top ones. And there have been so many tier two Chinese companies who you have not even heard back their name second time. So when you're buying a warranty, you have to understand that warranty has to come from a company who will at least stand with the product. And that's what, as Adani, you know, that's what we always tell our customers. You know, you're buying a product, at least Adani is a well-diversified group. You're buying a product, you know the company is going to stand with the warranty. Then the other logic with companies do give is that, okay, these Chinese companies will go, but there is insurance which is available. But there are deductibles also in that insurance. Yes, if you are doing a 100 megawatt, 200 megawatt project, that insurance has some weight. If you're doing a 5 megawatt project, what kind of, the deductibles itself is so high that insurance also does not have any value. So it's very important on who that company is which you're buying from, because that warranty has to have some value, and 25 years is a pretty long time.
Yeah, great. So I think we had a great discussion on variety of issues and concerns for the solar sector, both in the utility and the rooftop space right now. And I think what clearly emerges out of this discussion is the fact that the sector potential is quite promising. The prospects are definitely bright and quite favorable in the long run. No doubt about that. The government of India focus is pretty strong on the renewable energy sector per se in the long run. Most of the state governments who have renewable energy potential, they're also quite strongly encouraging the promotion of the renewable energy. What is required in many areas is the consistency in terms of approach at a policy level, consistency in terms of regulations in variety of matters we discuss related to net metering part in case of rooftop segment. So those consistency and uniform approach is required in many areas. That's one. Number two, more importantly in the utility space, the fact that DISCOMs are the ultimate off-takers. You know, their financial profile improvement is something which is a key monitorable. And for that, you know, the tariff adequacy, the subsidy support, you know, from the respective state governments, and more importantly, ability to curtail their, you know, T&D loss levels, you know, inefficiencies in line with the regulatory benchmarks. So these are the factors which would be monitored, and they would remain quite important for the DISCOMs to improve their financial profile. Because we have seen significant payment delays from many DISCOMs, you know, towards the IPPs, which in turn has led to, you know, the liquidity stress for them. So these are the areas where the things would be required to be done in the long run. But the bottom line is the sectoral prospects in the long run are quite bright and they are quite favorable. Although we are facing near-term challenges on variety of issues which we just discussed. So that's the key takeaway. Thank you. Thanks for the participation here.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I'll now request Mr. Kadam to distribute the mementos on behalf of organizers to all the panelists on the stage.